Hello and welcome to True Crime in Science, our brand new show that discusses real life cases but delves further into the forensic details behind them.
Criminal investigations used to be based on aspects like theory or word of mouth. It was possible for criminals to quite literally get away with murder, and it was a lot easier to incriminate the innocent.
Science has fundamentally changed the judicial system. In the last century, countless new techniques have been used to catch everything from petty criminals to the world's most notorious murderers.
It has helped solve cold cases from decades prior, filtered out crime in entire governments, and debunked conspiracy theories. But most importantly, science has deterred further crimes from being committed due to how likely it is now that said potential criminal would be caught.
While looking into some high-profile cases and perhaps some cases you may not have heard of, our main goal will be to break down the science used in forensics. I'm your host, Chris Carpinetti.
And I'm Eleanor Higgs, and today we're going to investigate how improvements in DNA evidence analysis managed to bring some of the world's most notorious murderers to justice.
Our main case, Colin Pitchfork, the first criminal caught using DNA profiling.
The year was 1983, the location, Leicestershire in England. 15-year-old Linda Mann was walking home from her job as a babysitter and had decided to take a shortcut home. The shortcut was known to people in the village as the Black Pad. However, she never returned home that evening. Naturally, her parents grew concerned and spent the entire night searching for her, along with the help of other local residents. Tragically, Linda was found dead the next morning. She had been strangled and raped in the secluded shortcut she took home.
In 1986, 15-year-old Dawn Ashworth was walking back from a friend's house. Dawn, who lived in Enderby, took a shortcut down a footpath known to locals as 10 Pound Lane. This lane actually joins up to the Black Pad where Linda was found 3 years earlier. Dawn, like Linda, never made it home that night, and 2 days later, she was found in a very similar manner to Linda.
The police took samples from both the girls and were able to find that whoever committed these crimes possessed both type A blood and secreted a specific PGM1 enzyme. PGM, which is short for phosphoglucotamutase, is an important metabolic enzyme that is found throughout the body. PGM1 is a mutated version of this enzyme, and therefore meaning it's rarer and will only show up in certain people who carry it. So with that, they deduced that a dual killer with a rare blood type was at large. Investigators got a lead when it came to light that a local kitchen porter named Richard Buckland, who was 17 years old at the time, seemed to know some details of the crime that had happened to Dawn, which hadn't been made public.
Richard was arrested and confessed to Dawn's murder. He later retracted the confession and did not confess to Linda's murder, but police charged him with the murder of both the girls regardless, despite the fact his blood test showed him not to be a PGM1 enzyme secretor. In the meantime, 5 miles away from where these horrific crimes had taken place, a geneticist named Alec Jeffreys had made an accidental yet pivotal discovery while researching how inherited diseases could be passed through generations.
Jeffreys had extracted DNA from cells and attached them to photographic film, which was then left in a photographic development tank. When he took it out, the film showed a sequence of bars, and Jeffreys realized that the individuals whose cells had been used in the experiments could be identified. We'll discuss this further shortly. Jeffreys was later asked to extract DNA from the killer's biological sample and compare it with DNA in Richard's blood. The results came back with a shocking revelation that Richard had not killed Dawn or Linda. His confession was a fabrication, and he became the first person acquitted for murder by the results of DNA fingerprinting.
Jeffreys also confirmed the semen belonged to one man, and this, paired with how accurate DNA typing seemed to be, led the police to conduct blood tests on every local male between the age of 16 and 34. After 8 months, 5,511 men had given samples, and only one had refused. But there was no match with the semen samples. The police were hoping the killer would not volunteer to give blood, and therefore would be suspicious of anyone who refused to cooperate in the investigation. In August of 1987, drinkers at a local Leicester pub were discussing the indecent sexual nature of an employee named Colin Pitchfork.
A man named Ian Kelly then brought up that Colin had bullied him into faking a passport and taking the blood test on his behalf, due to Colin's concerns that police would give him a hard time due to his previous convictions of indecent exposure. A woman listening to this conversation eventually went to the police with the information, and Colin was arrested. He made no attempt to deny the killings. After his blood was taken, it was shown to be an identical match to the DNA of the murderers. He pleaded guilty in court and also confessed that he had exposed himself to over 1,000 women and had committed other previous sexual assaults. Colin was jailed for life. What happened in the case of Colin Pitchfork was horrifying, but it was a revolutionary case that showed the fast progression of DNA profiling, something that, like a lot of famous scientific discoveries, was discovered by chance. Professor Alec Jeffreys was actually interested in the detection of genetic differences in humans. His answers came to him on a different project, however, one for the headquarters of the British Antarctic Survey. Jeffreys and his colleagues looked into the myoglobin gene, which is a protein that supplies oxygen to the cells in your muscles. They compared the differences in this gene between seals and humans, and they found that some short repeating sequences were the same in both organisms.
Professor Jeffreys recognised the repeating sequence could be informative genetic markers, known as mini-satellites. His group then developed a radioactive probe that could latch onto those repeating sequences and ultimately reveal patterns that were unique to each individual, aka a DNA fingerprint. We will break down Jeffreys' technique of DNA fingerprinting into four steps. DNA is taken from an organism. For forensic purposes, this would be at the crime scene. Blood is the most suitable tissue to extract, but it can also be in forms such as semen, hair, saliva, or skin. In forensic cases, samples are collected at the crime scenes in a way to avoid contamination and stored in a way to prevent degradation that could result in poor quality profiles.
The DNA is then mixed with a restriction enzyme. Restriction enzymes are proteins extracted from certain kinds of bacteria and are useful in DNA fingerprinting as well as in molecular biology. They cleave DNA sequences at recognition sites, most of which are palindromic, that is, they read the same way backwards as forwards. This produces DNA fragments with a known sequence at each end. The fragments will be of different numbers with different sizes. A person, unless they're an identical twin, will produce a unique DNA fingerprint pattern.
The DNA fragments are separated by size using a process called gel electrophoresis. This is a technique that is bread and butter of many molecular laboratories. In DNA fingerprinting, the DNA fragments produced by the restriction enzyme process are stained with ethidium bromide and pushed through an agarose gel by an electric current. This will move fragments through the gel, and the smaller they are, the further they will travel on the gel. If the process is left there, then it would be difficult to see anything, as the DNA fragments would produce a huge smear. Instead, a southern blot is then performed. This moves the DNA fragments from the gel to the membrane. Depending on the type of membrane, it will either then be baked in a vacuum or regular oven, or it will be exposed to ultraviolet radiation. This permanently attaches the transferred DNA to the membrane. A hybridization probe, which is a single DNA fragment with a particular sequence whose presence is to be ascertained from the target DNA, is exposed to the membrane. The probe DNA is labelled so that it can be detected, usually by incorporating radioactivity or tagging the molecule with a fluorescent or chromogenic dye such as ethidium bromide.
The pattern of DNA is detected by exposing the membrane to X-ray film. The result is a pattern of DNA bands that look like a supermarket barcode. Each individual has a signature fingerprint. DNA fingerprinting has been invaluable in the world of forensic science. It was used to catch other famous killers, such as the infamous Golden State Killer, aka Joseph James DeAngelo, who was arrested and charged with 13 counts of murder in 2018.
DeAngelo was linked to cold cases that dated back to 1974. To find him, public genealogy databases, which contained data about the victims, led them to DeAngelo himself when they matched their DNA to his from his old razors and napkins. They also connected him to 13 murders, 51 sexual assaults, and 120 burglaries. There was also baby Theresa, a deceased newborn found by the side of the road on June 5th, 2009, near Theresa, Wisconsin. DNA evidence identified baby Theresa's biological parents through DNA technology.
And of course, there was the infamous case of the Boston Strangler, who murdered 13 women in the 1960s.
To this day, authorities are not 100% certain who the culprit was for 12 of the murders. However, using DNA fingerprinting technology, the murder of one of the victims, Mary Sullivan, has been directly linked to a man named Albert DeSalvo.
DeSalvo actually confessed to her murder at the time, though the police thought he was lying. Her case remains unsolved until after DeSalvo's death in prison in 1973. In 2013, Boston exhumed DeSalvo's body so they can conduct a confirmatory test using DNA sample directly from DeSalvo. DNA extracted from a femur and three teeth gave them a match, which meant there was now no room for doubt that DeSalvo had raped and murdered Mary Sullivan, and quite possibly was the notorious Boston Strangler himself. DNA fingerprinting is a vital technological tool to help catch killers, but let's not forget it's also a vital tool for other fields too.
It's used in paternity tests, it can track down lost relatives, match organ donors to those who need transplants, and help look for cures for diseases of hereditary conditions. One discovery that has brought hope to countless families in one way or another.
Whether it's saving a life or bringing closure to the loved ones of a life taken, and importantly, DNA profiling has likely deterred potential criminals in fulfilling their acts of violence, a prime example of how the progression of science is the progression of humankind.
Thank you for watching our first episode.
Please like and share this video and consider subscribing if you would like to see more true crime and science videos.